I'm not even cool. I'm just one of those girls that can do a lot of and not die.
I'm keeping my car.
Keep your car if you do not let me in the house.
You're going to keep my car.
If you don't let me in the house, yes.
The video clearly shows the purpose and intent of the defendant. She chose a course of death and destruction that day. Exhibit 802 crystallizes the deadly decision-making of the defendant. She morphs from a responsible driver to literal hell on wheels as she makes her way down the street.
This is Mackenzie Shirilla. She was only 17 years old when, on July 31st, 2022, she decided she was frustrated with her relationship and the emotional turmoil her boyfriend put her through. In a moment of desperation, Mackenzie put into motion a plan that would devastate the lives of three families and shake the entire town of Strongville to its core. You guys, it is so gorgeous outside. Wouldn't you just love to work from a rooftop terrace somewhere? Personally, I love working from cafes, and that wouldn't be possible without NordVPN. Regular public Wi-Fi just won't do. I've seen people have their accounts hacked or their payment details stolen. Anything that can go wrong. I've either seen or heard about it. And with NordVPN, online protection couldn't be easier. It literally takes one click. With NordVPN, you can also get a dark web monitor, which notifies you if someone is trying to leak your info. And you can just turn on your kill switch to make sure your data is never exposed. But that's not all. As much as I love to travel to different countries, I hate missing out on my favorite shows back home. NordVPN allows you to connect to your home country's IP and tune in to your local streaming services. With one NordVPN account, you get to protect 6 devices. And as if all of this isn't cool enough, there's 24/7 customer support available. And in case you were wondering, yep, NordVPN is the fastest VPN in the world. It works for me, so you guys, what are you waiting for? Get the exclusive NordVPN deal here. It's risk-free with Nord's 30-day money-back guarantee.
No reasonable fact finder could view the totality of the evidence in this case and come to any other conclusion. Her actions were controlled, methodical, deliberate, intentional, and purposeful. This was not reckless driving. This was murder.
The story begins with what looks like a picture-perfect relationship. But in reality, this is only an illusion. The story gets much darker than anyone could have predicted. Mackenzie Shirilla was born in 2004 to parents Natalie Shirilla and John Steven. She and her family lived in Strongsville, Ohio. You could tell that Mackenzie had a privileged upbringing as there were only 2 children in her family, and their parents basically gave them everything they wanted. Mackenzie loved social media and would often post videos with her friends on her TikTok account, which is now private. While Mackenzie was a sweet little girl growing up, something began to change as she became a teenager. People who knew her described her as selfish and always taking the easy way out. She was impatient and reckless and would do things without thinking or caring about the consequences. You see, Mackenzie got away with a lot as a child. That gave her a false sense of invincibility, making her think she could do anything and get away with it. Although she did get away with them for a long time in her life, Mackenzie would soon find out that a healthy dose of accountability was just around the corner for her. As Mackenzie grew up, her parents thought they were raising a sweet, obedient daughter. Little did they know that their daughter was getting hooked on narcotics and violating sacred buildings like churches, all while high. These behaviors would escalate as Mackenzie started high school. She joined Strongsville High School, and that's where she met Dominic Russo. Though Dominic was older than her and ahead of her in school, Mackenzie wanted very badly to be with him. Dominic Russo was everything Mackenzie wanted, and she could already imagine their lives together. Dominic was born on September 24th, 2001 in Strongsville, Ohio, to Christine Angelo and Frank Russo. Dominic came from a big family, and he had 6 siblings. Although the family was large, love was never scarce in the Russo household. With 4 brothers and 2 sisters, Dominic never lacked friends or confidants. Everywhere he turned, there was always a hug and a smile waiting for him, and that taught him to pay the love forward. He loved people. people. He loved being around them and making them giggle. Dominic had a great sense of humor, and he never liked being sad, nor did he like when other people were sad. His siblings described him as the one who made them smile and always had the biggest smile on his face. Dominic was a happy-go-lucky boy who made the most of each day and had an impact on the lives of his friends and family. He had big dreams for his future and was already making plans to achieve them. At just 20 years old, Dominic was already a businessman, athlete, song producer, and entrepreneur. He was very passionate about learning more about himself and always being better than he was before. He was trying to understand more about people around him and understand situations better so that he could be a better friend to those around him. Dominic was also learning about different cultures so that he could have a better impact on his community. Dominic loved books and always wanted to expand his view on life by reading books that made him better. But he didn't just want to be better alone. He wanted to make everyone better. So he would recommend the books that changed his life to his siblings and other people around him. Dominic wasn't selfish. In fact, his siblings referred to him as the most selfless person they ever knew. His love for his community and country led him to make a decision about joining a branch of the military. Though his family didn't think that was a good idea at first, they soon came around to it when they discovered that his heart was in the right place. He saw his journey to the military as an opportunity to help people beyond the small town he grew up in. He wanted to be able to help people worldwide. But before Dominic could share his kindness and passion with the world, his life would be brutally cut short in a moment of jealous rage. Mackenzie and Dominic started dating somewhere around 2021. To Dominic, Mackenzie was a seemingly innocent girl, but he would soon be introduced to the horror that lay underneath those innocent eyes and pretty smile. Not long after Mackenzie and Dominic started dating, they became social media official. Mackenzie flooded social media with pictures of her and Dominic looking cozy and in love. From what people could see on social media, the two were made for each other. They were soulmates who vowed to find each other in another life. Their relationship looked unreal to their peers, and they were often envied for their closeness and banter. At first, things were perfect between Dominic and Mackenzie. They loved spending time together and found every opportunity to be near each other. Their families soon got to know each other, and it seemed like nothing could stand in the way of their young love. They shared their dreams with each other, and they couldn't wait to get out of high school and start their lives together out in the real world, where they would rather weather storms hand in hand. But soon, cracks began to develop. Mackenzie expected Dominic to go with everything she said, and Dominic didn't like how impatient Mackenzie was getting. But while they struggled to figure out how to balance the negatives in their relationship with the positives, they still projected an image of the perfect love on social media. People clicked and liked and commented goals on their photos, not knowing the reality of their relationship was not only far from perfect, but it was about to take a very dark turn. Once the problem started in their relationship, it only got worse. Mackenzie was getting even more frustrated that she couldn't bend Dominic to her will, and Dom was beginning to get tired of their toxic relationship. They started having disagreements. Disagreements turned into fights, and fights in the privacy of their homes had become public fights. Soon, the people who envied their relationship got a good look at what was actually going on underneath that picture-perfect facade they were displaying on social media. And Mackenzie did not like that. To make things worse, Dominic got to a point where he needed a break from the relationship. He wanted to be alone to figure things out. Mackenzie disagreed. She didn't want to give up on their relationship, but Dominic's mind was made up. He didn't see a way out and desperately wanted a break. So he broke up with Mackenzie. But what he didn't know was that that decision he made for his own sanity would set in motion a dangerous set of events that would lead to a deadly crash. Mackenzie wanted their relationship back on, and she wouldn't take no for an answer. She would show up at Dominic's house and threaten to destroy his property if he didn't let her in. Dominic found Mackenzie's antics funny and would record videos of Mackenzie outside his house threatening him. But what he didn't know at the time was those were not empty threats, and Mackenzie was already planning to make good on them. The more Dominic rejected Mackenzie, the more frustrated and desperate she got. She would alternate between begging him to take her back and threatening him if he didn't take her back.
That he overheard her make a statement. An admissible statement, and she said, "Dominic, I'm going to crash this car."
She became consumed with the idea of getting back together with Dominic. She planned and plotted different ways to make him see reason, but no matter how hard she tried, Dominic was not budging. The more he saw Mackenzie's antics, the more he realized the decision to end their relationship was the right one. But Mackenzie didn't care. As usual, she only thought of what she wanted and never considered Dominic's feelings. As time went on, Mackenzie became more desperate and antics started to escalate. It was no longer cute. It was beginning to get a little dangerous. It didn't matter the place or time. If Mackenzie saw Dominic, she would act out. Mackenzie didn't care if people saw her or not. She was far too gone to concern herself with what people saw. People were scared for Dominic, and they tried to warn him, but he only saw her antics as mildly annoying. He never thought she would one day commit the kind of violence she threatened him with. But he was about to find out just how serious Mackenzie was about those threats.
Yes. To break into his house?
Correct.
Did Dominic threaten the defendant?
No.
How would you describe Dominic's tone on these videos?
Very calm.
How would you describe the defendant's tone on these videos?
Irate and angry.
The fact that Dominic wasn't taking her seriously irritated Mackenzie, so her threats became more specific. She started threatening to hurt him in specific ways. She would threaten to end his life while driving super fast, but as usual, Dominic laughed off her threats. At this point, Dominic and Mackenzie had been broken up for months. Dominic was ready to move on and put their nightmare of a relationship behind him, but Mackenzie was holding on tight. She kept holding on to the illusion of this perfect relationship that they had. To her, there was no issue that couldn't be fixed if Dominic just forgave her and took her back. But this time around, Dominic was putting his foot down. He had seen a side of Mackenzie he didn't know existed during their breakup, and he wasn't ready to jump back in. Mackenzie was furious. Dominic had rejected her attempts at getting back together several times now, and it got to her. Mackenzie was shocked that Dominic didn't see her as his soulmate. She was devastated that Dominic had the nerve to not want her, and she wanted to make him pay for hurting her that way. But as much as she wanted to hurt him, she also loved him and couldn't bear the thought of Dominic being with someone else. So she decided if she couldn't have Dominic, no one could. Mackenzie knew what she had to do. She knew if she couldn't make Dom love her in this life, then she had to try again in the afterlife. So months before her 18th birthday, Mackenzie put a plan in motion. She decided she would do everything she could to make Dom take her back. And just when he trusted her, she would execute her plan. Mackenzie went back to trying to get Dom to take her back, but this time it was a little different. She stopped being aggressive and threatening and became calm and reasonable. She started showing the change that Dom wanted to see in her. She became the perfect girl. He would not be able to resist. And she was right. Dominic could not resist. He softened towards Mackenzie and they started hanging out again. Everyone around them thought Mackenzie had changed and they loved it for them. Dominic himself couldn't believe his luck. He was amazed by what he thought was a changed Mackenzie, and soon after they started hanging out, his feelings for her came back. Dominic suggested they get back together since Mackenzie had changed. Mackenzie agreed. She was beyond ecstatic. Her plans had worked. Dominic had fallen right into her hands, and she was about to make him pay. Mackenzie and Dominic started dating again. They agreed to take it slow and not put too much pressure on themselves like they did before. They went on a few dates and kept their relationship hush-hush. Only their close friends and family knew they had gotten back together. Some of those friends and family had a nagging suspicion about Mackenzie. They warned Dom that Mackenzie might only be acting like she wanted to get Dom back, but Dom wouldn't hear of it. He didn't see the harm in trying again. After a while of dating on the low, Mackenzie suggested they were ready to let people know that they were dating. They were having such a good time that Dominic did not disagree with Mackenzie. He thought they were ready too. So Mackenzie suggested they go to this small party a couple of friends were organizing. That way, only a few people would know about them. Dom was excited, but what he did not know was that by the time the party was over, his life would be over. Mackenzie had planned it perfectly. They would have a good time at the party, the proper goodbye, and then as she drove home in the morning, on the day before she turned 18, she would suddenly increase her speed and ram into a wall.
She chose the day. Specifically, she chose a day just before her 18th birthday. She chose to drive the car, the time to drive the car. She chose an obscure, previously scouted route through an industrial parkway.
She chose the target to hit and the victims.
To make sure her plan didn't fail, Mackenzie scouted for the perfect location, a remote road that didn't attract traffic, so there would be no delay and no one there to try to save their lives after the crash. So she also chose the time, 5 a.m., a time when most people in their small town of Strongsville were just getting up to get ready for the day. Mackenzie also chose the perfect target, a brick wall that would cause the most damage. That way, no one would survive her deadly plans. And just for good measure, Mackenzie drove through that road to make sure her plan would go off without a hitch. Once she was satisfied, Mackenzie put her horrific plan into motion. On July 30th, 2022, Mackenzie and Dominic attended a party. Most of their peers were happy to see the perfect couple back together. They danced the night away, drank, and did some narcotics. To Dominic, it was the perfect night. To Mackenzie, it was the perfect night, but for a totally different reason. While they were at the party, they met one of Dom's friends, Davian. Davian Flanagan was 19 years old, and he and Dominic were best friends. Davian was an amazing person and a good friend. Despite being shoved from foster home to foster home before being adopted in 2010, he didn't let that affect his good nature. After Davian graduated from Strongsville High School, he made plans for his future. His plans included going to barber school so that he could open a barber shop in their small town.
He was precious. He was an amazing soul with a heart of gold. He gave to the world what he wanted most in his own life, love.
He had big dreams and was excited to make them come true in the future, but the future he dreamed for himself was about to be drastically altered for life. Davian partied with Dominic and Mackenzie. They got high together and partied well into the early hours of the next day before crashing at their friend's house. At 5 a.m., Mackenzie woke Dominic up so they could make their way home. But as she was waking Dom up, Davian woke up as well. He asked Mackenzie if he could get a ride. Now, this was not part of Mackenzie's plans. She needed her and Dominic to be alone in that car so she could carry out her evil plans. But here was Davian asking her for a ride. Mackenzie knew she would not find another perfect time for her plans, and she did not want to have to do this another time. So even though she said yes to giving Davian a ride, she knew that Davian was going to become collateral in her plans to take Dominic's life and hers, and she didn't care. Mackenzie, Dominic, and Davian left their friend's party at around 5 a.m. and entered Mackenzie's 2018 Toyota Camry, heading to their deaths. Mackenzie was behind the wheel, her boyfriend Dominic in the passenger seat, and his friend Davian was sitting directly behind him in the back seat. No one but Mackenzie knows what exactly happened inside that car. Did they scream when they realized what she intended to do? Did they try to stop her or beg for their lives? No one but Mackenzie knows, and she would come up with a convenient story as to why she can't tell anyone what happened. At first, Mackenzie drove slowly, in perfect control of the car, but as she turned onto Almeda Drive from Pearl Road, she pressed her foot on the gas and refused to let go as she hit 100 miles per hour and sped through the industrial complex, driving straight for a brick wall. Because it was the early hours on a Sunday, the industrial complex was eerily quiet as Mackenzie drove two people to their deaths. As she predicted, no one was around to save them. It would take 45 minutes for one woman to spot the totaled car and call 911. By the time the paramedic got there, Dominic Russo and Davian Flanagan were gone. Mackenzie was holding on by a thread, her fuzzy Prada slippers stuck to the accelerator. She was immediately rushed to the hospital, where she received multiple surgeries to save her life. Mackenzie survived. Dominic and Davian did not. As officers combed through the crime scene trying to piece together the truth of what led Mackenzie to do such a horrific thing, they found a bag of magic mushrooms and a digital scale in Mackenzie's pockets. Mackenzie also tested positive for THC above the legal limit under Ohio law. At first, the police thought Mackenzie drove through the wall because she was high. But as the investigation progressed, they discovered something else, something that would send shockwaves through their spines. The seemingly innocent-looking Mackenzie had carefully planned the deaths of her boyfriend, Dominic Russo, and his best friend, Davian Flanagan. The DUI charge quickly took a backseat as the Strongsville police and Cuyahoga County prosecutors eyed a much bigger charge, murder. During the course of the investigation, officers also discovered Mackenzie was involved in a separate incident. On July 19th, 2022, Mackenzie broke into the Columbia Church of God in Columbia, Ohio. She vandalized and desecrated the sacred church. The police had no choice but to bring charges against her for breaking and entering and vandalism. But a vandalism charge was not going to be Mackenzie's biggest worry. She was about to be held accountable for the first time in her life. When Mackenzie woke up in the hospital and realized she had survived, she was hit with a wave of guilt. She started crying to her doctors, telling them she had murdered her boyfriend on purpose.
Patient stated she, open quote, wanted to die, close quote, and that it was her fault for killing her boyfriend.
Although the doctors thought it was just the ramblings of a guilty driver, the prosecution did not. After undergoing multiple surgeries, Mackenzie was released from the hospital and her parents took her home. While the Shirellis were planning to welcome their daughter home, the Russos and Flanagans were planning funerals for their sons. As Mackenzie was healing at home, the prosecutor's office was conducting a thorough investigation to bring charges against Mackenzie. On November 4th, 2022, Mackenzie Shirella was arrested and faced 12 charges, including 2 counts of aggravated murder, 4 counts of murder, 2 counts of aggravated vehicular homicide, 4 counts of felonious assault, trafficking, drug possession, and possession of criminal tools. She was taken to a juvenile detention facility as she was 17 at the time. Mackenzie waived her rights to a jury trial, instead opting for a judge to decide her fate. During her trial, Mackenzie's chilling behavior before and after the car crash was unveiled for all to see. The prosecutor sought to prove to the judge that Mackenzie had been violent to Dominic Russo during the course of their relationship several times.
He observed at that time the defendant striking Dominic Russo with both hands.
The prosecution also presented a witness who overheard Mackenzie threaten to kill Dominic in a car crash 2 weeks before July 31st.
He overheard her make a statement, an admissible statement, and she said, "Dominic, I'm going to crash this car." We find that it is especially and important to her state of mind just 2 weeks later when she used a car to kill Dominic Russo.
Prosecutors told the judge that a black box inside the vehicle showed Mackenzie put the gas pedal to the floor and never attempted to brake. After Mackenzie was released, she made a disturbing TikTok that mocked the car crash with a very chilling caption. It read, "Google Mackenzie Shirella, Strongsville, Ohio."
I'm not even cool. I'm just one of those girls that can do a lot of and not die.
But that's not all Mackenzie did. The prosecutors also argued that Mackenzie spent 3 months before she was arrested partying, going to concerts, and soliciting for model jobs.
After the crash, Strongsville police were notified that they had received concerning emails from the community that the defendant and her mother were seeking employment with the Los Angeles modeling agency.
The prosecutors showed a screenshot of a conversation between an LA modeling agency that wanted to use Mackenzie's pictures only a few weeks after the crash.
Mackenzie Shirella said to Vitaly, "Thank you for the comment. I would love to work with you guys. I've been emailing you guys a lot. Such a great opportunity. Thank you."
It didn't stop there. The prosecutor also revealed that Mackenzie attended a concert in a wheelchair shortly after being released from the hospital.
Shortly after being released from the hospital, the police were provided additional videos of the defendant from her wheelchair as she attended a concert down in the flats. And again, Your Honor, I'm introducing these to the court to show the shocking lack of remorse.
The prosecution showed that Mackenzie wasn't at home mourning the deaths of her boyfriend and his friend. Rather, she was making TikToks with her friends only weeks after the crash. While the prosecution put forward their evidence to show Mackenzie had no remorse for what she did to Dominic and Davian, Mackenzie's defense team argued she was innocent and it was all an accident. Mackenzie's team tried to show that Mackenzie went out partying and drinking because she had been stuck in the house crying for weeks after the crash and she needed a break. They also insisted Mackenzie was innocent and the entire crash was a terrible accident she couldn't remember.
Your Honor, this was a terrible, tragic, nightmare accident to have happened that she has no memory of and she will never emotionally or physically recover from it.
Mackenzie's mom, Natalie Shirella, gave a statement about how depressed Mackenzie was after the crash. She also said she was the one who encouraged her to go out after being cooped up in the house for weeks crying.
Halloween, For 3 months after the accident, she would only wear his clothes. She would only eat the snacks he ate. She would only listen to the music he wrote, okay? She was laying in bed for 3 months crying.
Her mother insisted that Mackenzie was sad the entire time, and the only time she stepped out of the house was for Dom.
So she was crying for 3 months, so her friends asked if she wanted to go out trick-or-treating or Halloween, and it was at OU. And she didn't even want to go. She said, I don't know, should I go? She couldn't even walk yet, barely. So I told her, I said, baby, please go.
As Mackenzie's mom continued to defend her daughter's behavior, the judge was quick to tell her that while she was making her daughter out to be a victim, she was not saying anything about the actual victims of the crash.
I'm hearing an awful lot about your daughter. I'm not hearing very much about
it. Dominic, okay, I'm asking you for a leniency because this was a tragic accident that she does not remember.
Mackenzie's mom goes on to say Mackenzie should be pardoned because Dominic was the love of her life and she didn't really know Davian.
And Davian, he's a new friend. I'm so sorry. No. They all loved each other. They all spent every day together. You know what I mean? I don't know too much for him. Sorry?
Isn't that part of the problem?
It's not a problem at all. It was wonderful.
Mackenzie Shirilla also gave testimony in court. She testified that she has no memory of the crash because everything went black just before the car crashed, but she never wanted to murder the love of her life.
I'm not the baby. I'm so deeply sorry. I hope one day you can see I would never let this happen or do it on purpose. I wish I could remember what happened. I'm just so sorry. I'm heartbroken.
After the prosecution and defense rested, it was now time for the judge to render her verdict.
And all of their lives have been irrevocably changed because of the actions of the defendant. The unintended and collateral consequences of a selfish, intentional, and cruel decision by Mackenzie will ripple forever in time.
But before the judge handed down the verdict, she spoke directly to Mackenzie.
The video clearly shows the purpose and intent of the defendant. She chose a course of death and destruction that day. Exhibit 802 crystallizes the deadly decision-making of the defendant. She morphs from a responsible driver to literal hell on wheels as she makes her way down the street.
The judge emphasized Mackenzie's actions were not accidental. They were intentional and calculated. The judge took into account the prosecution's evidence that she scoured the route before that fateful day.
The defendant controlled all the events. She chose the day. Specifically, she chose a day just before her 18th birthday. She chose to drive the car, the time to drive the car. She chose an obscure, previously scouted route through an industrial parkway. She chose the target to hit and the victims.
The judge was clear that the evidence presented by the prosecution showed Mackenzie's actions were intended to lead to the death of Dominic Russo.
No reasonable fact finder could view the totality of this evidence in this case and come to any other conclusion. Her actions were controlled, methodical, deliberate, intentional, and purposeful. This was not reckless driving. This was murder.
The judge finally handed down a guilty verdict.
Court renders the following verdicts. Count one. The court, having had count one tried to it pursuant to waiver, finds the defendant, Mackenzie Shirilla, guilty of murder, to wit Dominic Russo.
The judge found Mackenzie guilty of all 12 charges she faced, including murder, aggravated vehicular homicide, felonious assault, and drug possession for a 2022 crash that killed her boyfriend, Dominic Russo, and friend, Davian Flanagan. She was sentenced to 2 concurrent sentences of 15 years to life with the possibility of parole after 15 years. The families of Dominic Russo and Davian Flanagan were disappointed with the verdict as they hoped for a consecutive life sentence, but they were happy Mackenzie was found guilty of the murders of their sons. Hey, thanks for watching. What are your thoughts on this case? Do you know of other similar cases? Let me know in a comment, and before you go, make sure you like, subscribe, and hit that bell button. See you next time, and stay safe.